This is week three, the Cold War, and we're going to traverse that period approximately 1950 to 1979. Probably thinking, why 79? It's an odd number date. Yeah, it sure is. It sure is, but that's where we're going to approximately cut it off here. And then next week we'll go from 79 till now. Interspersed in that will be, obviously here, the nuclear arms race. But we're going to go through from 1950 to 1979 various aspects of this Cold War competition between Washington and Moscow. Something I'm sure you, many of you folks remember because you lived this era. Remember that? Yeah, sure. Sure. Cold War. Of course, that begs the question, did the Cold War ever really end? There's a question for you. He's shaking his head no. Yeah, Gorbachev, she says, but were the missiles ever really turned? I mean, did they really turn their missiles away from each other? You know, maybe it's been transformed. Let's maybe talk about it like that. Of course, that's really for next week. And if we have enough time, if you want to get into what the new administration might be planning to carry us forward, we can perhaps do that too. But going back to the what we'll call the post-World War II era, post-1945 era. If you look at that handout, the first one, the first two pages of that handout actually come from the UN. The first page shows you what effect a Hiroshima style of bomb might have had on New York City. If you go to, and that's about 15, 20,000 tons of TNT. That's approximately what the Hiroshima bomb was the equivalent of. Of course, if you go to the next page, gives you an idea of what a Soviet nuclear warhead of many, many more tons could have done to New York City and the surrounding area going back to the 1980s. A lot wider path of destruction, isn't there? Yeah, the Hiroshima bomb was, for all intents and purposes, a pop gun, if you want to use that terminology comparison. And so the atomic weaponry changes the idea of approaching strategy here. You know, the idea is we do not want a large, large war, which again goes back to George Kennan and his idea of containment here. Why don't we use the American economy? That's our ace in the hole. Our economy is better than the Soviet economy. Obviously here, our political alternative is maybe a bit more palatable than the Soviet variety. You would think, at least on the surface, people would want to gravitate to us more than they would the Soviets. If we use our propaganda in an expert fashion, if we use our intelligence services in an expert fashion, sure, we're eventually going to have to fight the occasional brush fire war, but we don't want to have a large conflict like 1939, 1945. That we don't want to do. That we don't want to do. However, what's interesting here is when you go back to this period, you know, when the war is over, 1946, and Mr. Stalin appoints one of his ace commissars, Andrei Danov, who actually was one of the major commissars at the siege of Leningrad, and helped to organize the people for its defense. He will be in charge of a purge, starting in 1946. You know, the Great Patriotic War, as the Soviets called this, is over. Now it's time to purge anybody who has any degree of perhaps not being on the same page with the Soviet leadership. People like writers, journalists, historians perhaps, teachers, anybody who shows the slightest deviation from the cause here will need to be purged. This is what Stalin's going to do. Again, we're all done here with the Great Patriotic War. And as I mentioned perhaps before, the great Soviet general Georgi Zhukov, who was considered a threat at this time, the war is over. is going to be demoted in stature. His picture will be expunged from Soviet books, photographs, whatever the case may be. And he will be demoted to the Odessa Military District, which is, for all intents and purposes, like being named the commander of that army post in Kansas, which featured Sergeant Bilko. And so that's what Stalin did. At the same time, if you go to 1950, what develops in this country? McCarthy hearings? We're doing the same sort of thing in this regard, folks. We're not that much different than the Soviet Union in this regard. Of course, we're not shooting them, but, you know, I mean, the case of the matter is we are purging people. In the McCarthy hearings, who lost China? We know who lost China. Chiang Kai-shek lost China. That right-wing extremist slash fascist that we supported during the war. Interesting. Boy, he ran the gamut here. First he had help from the Soviets, then he had help from the Nazis, then he had help from us. Boy, we sure know how to pick them. Mao Zedong won that. You know, Chiang lost. Simple as that. No matter what we did, it wasn't going to save Chiang Kai-shek, short of getting involved ourselves. And I don't think the American public was willing to do that. And so you see here developing if you go to the Marshall Plan. Again, I mentioned this last week, and I'm going to repeat here, the Marshall Plan. Here you see, you know, this idea that we save the world. Well, there's a lot of truth to that. There's a lot of truth to that. However, let's understand why the Marshall Plan is formed here. One of those who co-authors this is George Kennan. And one of the reasons we're going to have the Marshall Plan is not because we're overly nice people, we want to help our brother man, we want to fashion markets for the post-war. We have this huge industrial combine. We've got over 16, according to the VA, 16,112,000 Americans were in a uniform. Not all of them are going to stay in the services. You know, you're only going to have 1 to 1.2 million in the services by the time they're done, getting people out of the service for peacetime. And most of these guys don't want to stay in the service. So you're going to have to find jobs for 15 million guys. You know, some of the women are going to go back to the kitchen, but not all of them. That has changed, too. You know, it is kind of hard to tell the ladies at this point after two wars or two chapters of the same war, you know, women who went into the plants. Kind of hard to say in 1945, sorry, ladies, the deal is off, back to the kitchen. Kind of hard at that point. So the world's changing here. It's what you're seeing here. But we need to fashion markets for the post-war. Some of you folks, I'll bet, can remember those days when we were the only ones making the cars, the television sets, the washing machines, the telephones. Remember that?
Was that when America was great? Sorry.
When America was great.
That's one take on it. However, having said that, to have expected the world to remain in that posture is kind of ludicrous. If we are fashioning these areas, I'm talking Europe and Japan in particular, to be dumping grounds for our goods, and this is what great powers try to do anyway. We are no different here. I mean, Britain used India as a dumping ground for years. It was the crown jewel of their empire. So we are no different in this respect. But to have expected the Europeans and the Japanese to, you know, be on the receiving end and not recover themselves, that's kind of short-sighted. It's kind of short-sighted, and that leads to another discussion, too, as we go along here. But having said that, you see the sides being chosen up here. 1948, a Soviet-sponsored coup makes sure that Czechoslovakia will stay in the Eastern Bloc. And that was an interesting thing about the Marshall Plan, too. Moscow wouldn't let Eastern Europe be recipients of those goods or that program. Of course, Stalin understands what it means if he accepts the American dollar. He understands what that means. No, he's not stupid. He saw what happened to the British, the Ethiopians, the Egyptians. He saw what happened to them. He doesn't want that happening to the Soviet Union, where the British came here hat in hand for $3.7 billion just after the war. They need money to tide them over. Yeah, you can have that money, but guess what? $930 million of it has to be spent here. Oh, and by the way, all your imports have to be either gold, paid for in gold or dollars. They've only got 12 million of gold left. How far do you think that's going to go? And don't think you're going to get a better deal from your Commonwealth partners, because if so, our deal is off. Ethiopians, yeah, you can have some money, but guess what? We get air bases if you're going to have them, not the British. Yeah, the Egyptians, you can have some money, but guess what? American Airlines get priority for the Egyptian to European runs and back before European Airlines do. Stalin wants no part of that action. Wants no part of that action at all. That's what he understands as what's going to happen if he accepts the dollar. And it was meant, and it was the world's reserve currency, still is, for all intents and purposes at this point, which is another bone of contention at this point, because there are nations that don't want the dollar as the world's reserve currency anymore. But this is no longer 1944, this is 2016. That does accrue numerous advantages for us. Of course, one of the major building blocks for foreign policy in the post-1945 era was control of energy. Oil, let's start there. You know, you go back to what Mr. Roosevelt understood during the war, that 6 of every 7 barrels of oil burned by the Allies came from the United States, not counting the Soviet Union. 6 of every 7 barrels of oil burned by the Allies came from the United States, and we will burn 30% of our reserves. It's a massive war. And so what's going to happen after that? Well, just before he dies, Franklin D. Roosevelt will make the deal with Abdulaziz Ibn Saud in Saudi Arabia. U.S. military protection for the kingdom versus preferential access to Saudi crude, and every president, be he Democrat and Republican, has catered to this agenda ever since. This is what Dick Cheney's going to outline when he sits before the Senate subcommittee in September of 1990 about why we need to throw Saddam out of Kuwait. Of course, what did you see on the 6 o'clock news? They're ripping the babies out of the incubators, they're raping the women, so on and so forth. That's not what Cheney is telling that Senate subcommittee. He's telling them the real stuff, not the stuff for public consumption. That's meaningless. But this is very important here. Control of energy. Roosevelt understood that we need not only control our own, but beyond our borders. Welcome to the Middle East, folks. We are now assuming the British colonial empire for all intents and purposes. We are the nation best equipped to oversee Western interests. And they need cheap oil, you know, especially the British and the French. If you want to maintain them as powers of note, they need cheap energy. Of course, this is going to lead to unpleasantries down the road. It really will. Having said that, how about Korea? Now, one of the great tragedies coming out of the Second World War is Korea. You can understand why Germany's going to be occupied. You can understand why Japan will be occupied, or even what was fascist Italy. You can understand why they're occupied. They lost. Korea? Was Korea part of the Axis powers? No. They've been occupied by Japan. It's going to be cut in half between the United States and the Soviet Union. 38th parallel. Remember watching Dean Rusk in an older interview, and he talking about how Army historians and State Department historians missed the fact that the demarcation line, 38th parallel, had been discussed by the Russians and the Japanese prior to the 1945 Russo-Japanese War. And he says, heck, if we knew that, we never would have agreed to that line. What does that make us look like? We're no different than the Japanese and the Russians? Perhaps. perhaps. But of course, what happens here on June 25, 1950? Kim Il-sung sends his army across the 38th parallel, and the Korean Civil War is on. The idea is to unify the peninsula under the banner of Pyongyang. They will nearly do that, closeting up what was left of the South Korean army and their allies from the UN in the Pusan perimeter in the south. Of course, that's going to change on September 15, 1950, when MacArthur lands Marines at Incheon. And now the Allied forces will break out of the Pusan perimeter, and they will push the North Koreans north to the 38th parallel, and then the great discussion begins. What do we do at this point? Do we cross the 38th parallel? MacArthur wants to do this, even to the point of having Chiang Kai-shek launch an offensive off Taiwan under the Chinese mainland. Paul Nitzsche, who writes National Security Council 68, a more militant form of American foreign policy per what George Kennan believed in, urges crossing the 38th parallel. The Joint Chiefs of Staff will fall into the line, and eventually Truman will. People like George Kennan say, no, you're only going to get the Chinese involved in the war. And the idea of containment is to push them out of South Korea and then stop at the 38th parallel. That is containment. Because if you don't, the Chinese will get involved. What's going to happen a month and a half later after they cross the 38th parallel? 300,000 Chinese, and the Chinese Mao calls them volunteers, cross the frozen Yalu, and the Korean War takes a new course. And you'll see this conflict go on for almost another 2.5 years. And much of that, a stalemate, not too unlike World War I. Mr. Kennan was right about that. What's happening in Southeast Asia? French Indochina, what they call French Indochina at this point. Ho Chi Minh has organized the Viet Minh against the French. What the Vietnamese used to call the First Indochina War. Our incursion will be known as the Second Indochina War. But the first French Indochina War, in the beginning, the French aren't doing too bad, except at this point, the Viet Minh will take to the countryside after being pushed out of the cities. And like Mao said, Mao and Giap, we will take our place in the countryside, and that's what we'll control first. They control the villages. They control the peasants. That's what they're going to control. That's their ace in the hole. Mao did the same thing in China against Chiang Kai-shek. Don't abuse the peasant. Don't abuse the peasant's wife. Help the peasant fix his house. Help the peasant plant his crops. Help the peasant reap his crops when you're not fighting. Help the peasant. So who do you think the peasants are going to go with? Chiang Kai-shek, who's abusing him, or Mao Zedong, who's helping him? That choice seems clear enough. And the peasants will go with the communists. You know, peasants aren't interested in Wall Street ticker tapes. They're interested in the dirt they're digging in. If you promise the peasant you're going to give them land, brother, do you have a friend? That's what happens here. You know, Castro isn't too much different here. Ho is virtually the same thing. Control the peasants. It shouldn't be hard to figure this out. Emiliano Zapata was doing this before they did in Mexico, in Morelos in southern Mexico during the Mexican Revolution. That's pre-communist. Interesting how that is. Remember that movie Viva Zapata with Marlon Brando? Yeah, and Anthony Quinn. I think Anthony Quinn was nominated for an Oscar for that role, I think. The supporting actor, I believe. So it's interesting what you see develop here. 1953, the Korean War will wind up as a stalemate. They're back to where they started, 38th parallel. Not so Vietnam. There, the French are going to get their eviction notice at Dien Bien Phu in May 1954. And the Viet Minh really put a full court press on winning this battle and bloodying the French nose because of the discussions that are due, the Geneva Accords. If you win the battle, you know, if you win on the battlefield, does help your discussions when you sit at the conference table. Does help a lot. Does help a lot. And what's going to happen here? Well, Vietnam's going to be divided at the 17th parallel. The French are out of North Vietnam. Now they're in South Vietnam. We are going to become more deeply involved here. Now, what's fascinating is what you see come out of this. You know, again, go back to 1949. We'll jump into nuclear weapons here. What happens in 49? The Soviets explode their first atomic bomb, right? Yeah. 1953, they'll explode their first hydrogen bomb. And so in North Vietnam, March, April, going into May, the discussions are going on here. Do we help the French? Do we help the French? The French want help, but they still want to maintain control of Vietnam. They don't want to give that up, but they want our help. I mean, keep in mind here at this point, the American taxpayer is in this war before the American soldier is. You go from 1953 into 1954, courtesy of the United States taxpayer, we're paying 78% of the freight here to the tune of $1.063 billion. That's a lot of money in 1954. And it's discussed, Operation Vulture. Well, maybe what we can do is have some B-29s take off, 60 of them from the Philippines, escorted by 150 carrier fighters, and we'll pound the North Vietnamese troops surrounding the French at Dien Bien Phu. Admiral Arthur Radford is for this, the Navy. General Nathan Twining of the Air Force is for this. Matthew Ridgway isn't a big proponent of this, because he says if you want to get into this war, it's going to take 7 divisions. And if the Chinese get involved again, it'll take 12 divisions. However, let's understand one thing here. We still have to maintain troop strength in Europe to face off against the Soviet tank armies. The idea is even floated, well, maybe we'll drop a couple of 3 low-level nukes in the mountains. And Eisenhower says, if you do that, we'll have to deny it for 20 years. And so, Mr. Eisenhower, you know, it's nice that we want to help the French. However, Mr. Eisenhower is also under the opinion, well, you know, he understands the gravity of what Mr. Truman did by not going before Congress and asking for that declaration of war to get us in Korea. And Eisenhower says, I want reassurance from Congress. Of course, he understands that if he's going to take the fall, you think he wants to be the only one? Of course not. You know, and help from the British, they don't want to get involved in this. And so the whole idea is scrapped, and the French lose. You know, and then you get somebody like Lyndon Baines Johnson, who in 1954 as a member of Congress says, get involved in Vietnam. John F. Kennedy, young congressman, get involved in Vietnam. That's why. Keep in mind, Korea's fresh here. And what is it Mr. MacArthur will later say? It's a mistake to get involved in a land war in Asia. Gee, you think? Ask the Germans about that one. 4 years on the Russian steppe. They'll give you an idea. Yeah, interesting what you see come out of this. Fascinating what you see. The Geneva Accords, you see Vietnam again, split at the 17th parallel. The Viet Minh in the north, the French in the south. Of course, the French are eventually going to pull out. Who's going to take over that chore? We will. Middle East. Let's not forget that, because that's where a lot of the oil is. Right? Of course. You see coming out of, again, you see here this revolutionary nationalism that's really, really taking effect on the world stage here. Mao Zedong, Ho Chi Minh. Let's go to the Middle East. How about Gamal Abdel Nasser? The Free Officers Movement. Yeah, that's important. And how about what you're seeing in Iraq going on right now? There's a bubbling up of discontent among the people who have been under the thumb of Nuria Syed, that British lackey, ex-officer from the Ottoman army, who sold his country down the river when it was formed anyway, as a British lackey. You even see happening in Iraq now, and this is interesting too, something called the Wathbat, which was in 1948 an uprising among the Iraqi people to be put down. But you see here, even in a country that's heavily Islamic, there's hardly any Christian, there's not that many Christians or Jewish people living here. And you know, when the Communist Party was first formed, that's basically a European idea. How many people are going to join the Communist Party if they're not Christian or Jewish? But after the Wathbat, yeah, interesting. More workers, more peasants were joining the Communist Party. Muslims in a secular agenda here. That's fascinating. And so this idea of independence or sovereignty is resonating. And it's interesting because when Mr. Nasser takes over in Egypt as a representative of this pan-Arabist movement, we're all Arabs here in the Middle East. This is almost like the Ehrenvolk in Germany. No matter where a German is, he or she is German, makes no difference here. This idea of pan-Arabism, Arab nationalism, Arab socialism, for Arabs and for no one else. And of course, he wants to be the leader of this. He'll get the okay from London and Washington to take out King Farouk. Remember that ponderous King Farouk? I always remember the Honeymooners. That was my favorite show. When Ralph comes home one day, and he finds this ring on the table. He thinks it's from Ed Norton to his great pal in the sewer, only Ralph thinks it's for him, and he puts this little ring on, and he can't get it off. And Norton says to Alice, he goes, "Ralph put that ring on his finger, that's like King Farouk getting into Gary Cooper's bathing suit." Jeez. But you see here that now Nasser is taking command of this pan-Arabist movement. One of those movements that comes out of the collapse of the British and French colonial systems. This movement had been coming on here for quite a while. With the collapse of the Ottomans. There were various movements coming out. Michael Aflaq, the Syrian political theorist, helps to put together the Ba'ath Party. Another secular agenda. Interesting, what he and other theorists did, they put this Ba'ath Party idea together based off ideas they gleaned from fascism, Nazism, Marxism, and socialism. Interesting the model for this. Liberty, unity, and socialism. The original idea of socialism was to spread this through workers cross borders. That's not what the Arabs want. It's socialism for Arabs only. Everyone else need not apply. Unity. We're all Arabs here. This is part of the Ba'ath Party agenda. It's another pan-Arabist agenda. We're all Arabs. Liberty. Now, what is your idea of liberty? Freedom of the individual? Isn't that what you were taught since a kid, since a child? Isn't that what you were taught? That's not the agenda here. Liberty or freedom. From European colonialism. That's not the freedom of the individual. However, it makes sense. Pan-Arabist movement, free of outside encroachments. And then you wonder why some of these people don't like the West. Keep in mind, some of those people involved in the Islamic State are ex-Ba'ath Party. They're not all religious fanatics. Which leads to the rationale of some foreign policy gurus that think that the reason the Islamic State, at least for a short period of time, enjoyed some success in running villages, towns, and a couple of cities because the Baathists had already had previous experience in Saddam's Iraq with civil administration. Which leads me to think that if by chance they'd ever taken Baghdad, how long do you think that coalition would have lasted? Would there have to have been a civil war between the factions in the Islamic State? Could be, but I mean, we may never see that now. But stay tuned, you never know. But this is what you're seeing develop here. And yes, there are those who are more or less the very conservative so-called Islamic agenda, like Hassan al-Banna, who was one of the co-founders of the Muslim Brotherhood, or Sayyid Qutb. In fact, if you read The Management of Savagery, which is the manifesto for the Islamic State, Qutb is mentioned in this manifesto. And he's highly regarded. He is a forerunner or a seed planter, if you will, for people like Osama bin Laden. Fuad Ajami, that writer from the Middle East who has since passed on, always said that if Osama bin Laden was the jihadi Che Guevara, then Sayyid Qutb was its Lenin. Now that's interesting. That's interesting. Qutb will be hung by Nasser in 1966 for plots against Nasser. He will be hung. But the effect has carried on beyond him. Has carried on beyond him. 1953. We see that the Persians, the Iranians, right, have the temerity to want to nationalize their oil at the expense of the British. Mohammad Mossadegh, an elected leader, what's going to happen there? The United States, the CIA, and British MI6 are going to dethrone them. The British just can't afford to pay higher prices for oil. Interesting what you're seeing develop here, and this develops into, you know, John Foster Dulles had input on this development. And of course, the following year, we are going to launch another coup against Jacobo Arbenz down in Guatemala, another elected leader we don't likely take out. A trend is developing here. America is acting like a big power in the face of its Cold War competitor, the Soviet Union. That's exactly what we're doing here. 1955, you know, 1954, 55, 56. When you step back and take a look at the map, the Americans and British are so, or the West is concerned that perhaps Russia can get into the Middle East. So a couple of alliances are tried here to build buffer zones for the British. The Baghdad Pact. Oh, that's interesting. Turkey, Iraq, and Pakistan. We, on the other hand, John Foster Dulles, not to be outdone, we put together something called the Northern Tier of Nations. Turkey, Iran, and Afghanistan. Now notice, within these amalgamations, only one country is an Arab country. They're Turks. The Iranians are Persians. The Afghans, they're not Arabs, they're Afghans. Again, with the other one, Turkey, Iran, again Iran, but Iraq is the only Arab nation, and Pakistan from Asia. Why? The Arabs don't want to be involved. The Arabs don't have the same agenda here as the United States and the Soviet Union. You know, we see this area not just for energy, but a combat zone. It's like a chessboard, an area to be contended with your opponent, Moscow. That's not what the Arabs see here. The Arabs are looking this in two ways. Are looking at this in two ways. Number one, this idea of Arab nationalism. If you go back to the Damascus Protocol in 1914, the idea was to have an Arab homeland. Doesn't happen, but the idea was to have a homeland. Perhaps this is one of the things that's interesting about the Islamic State. At one point, they had taken out the border between, or a lot of the border between Iraq and Syria. They want to do away with the 19th, and this year is the 100th anniversary, the Sykes-Picot Agreement. Have one Arab homeland. And the other thing of importance to the Arabs? Israel. That's their local agenda. They could give a hoot and heck about Vietnam, and they could care about Korea, they could care about that stuff. Their local agenda. 1955, Nasser comes calling. I want arms. Yeah, okay, but you're not getting them from us. So who do you think he's gonna go to? That's it, the Soviets. Although going through Czechoslovakia approaches Prague. Yeah, sure, but of course, you know, Prague has to clear this with Moscow. And they do clear it. And so Nasser's gonna start getting arms from the Soviets. What happened to that Baghdad Pact and the northern tier of nations to keep the Soviets out of the Middle East? They just jumped over it, like a checker game. They jumped over it. Now they're in Egypt. Interesting what you see here. Interesting what you see develop here. Aren't the Soviets going to be involved in building that Aswan Dam, the Nile River? Mm-hmm. That could have been American and British construction companies, or French, whatever. Soviets. So now they've been able to install themselves in the Middle East. America, Mr. Eisenhower. You know, post-Korea, good thing we didn't get involved in Vietnam. Mr. Eisenhower does not want to turn this country into a garrison state. Goes with this idea called the New Look Defense Posture. And a part of this New Look Defense Posture is massive retaliation. He wants America to remain a strong power, but he doesn't want to break the bank doing it. He knows the ace in the hole, like Mr. Kennan is, a viable economy. That's what he believes. And so what are we going to do about it? Well, we're going to cut the army from 20 divisions to 14. We're going to mothball some ships and demobilize 100,000 men of the Navy. However, the Air Force will be allowed to take on another 30,000 souls, and their air wings will go up from 117 to 137. You got the B-47 and the B-52 coming online, and obviously the idea here is to mate it up with the atomic bomb and the hydrogen bomb. That will be our deterrent. That will be our deterrent, bouncing off what we did in World War II. Of course, now this is a distinct difference in the wrinkle here. You had in World War II, you'd send over 500, 750, 1,000 bombers over a German or Japanese city. They dropped their loads, and that's it. Now, what do you have to do? Now what can you do with an atomic or hydrogen bomb? Maybe 3, 4, 6 planes? Why do you need 1,000 for it at a time? You don't need that anymore. That's the deterrent. However, don't you think the Soviets are learning too? Again, you know, this isn't going to last all that long. And the nuclear arms race is on, just like the great battleship race in the early 20th century, which was the world's first modern strategic arms race. Now you have another strategic arms race. It's not battleships anymore, it's nuclear weapons. It's nuclear weapons. 1956, the Suez Crisis. Well, Nasser wants to nationalize the Suez Canal. What happened there? Anthony Eden, the British Prime Minister, says we are not going to allow Nasser to have his hand on our windpipe. Well, a lot of the oil they're getting from Persia is going where? Through the Suez Canal? Yeah. Eisenhower warns them, don't go to war with the Egyptians. Yet what are the British and French going to do? That's exactly what they're going to do. And Eisenhower, this is one time where Moscow and Washington were on the same page. And what is Eisenhower going to do? He's going to adopt some draconian measures here against the British, if you believe that. He will put a lot of weight against the British pound in the UN, even to the point of trying to cut off their oil. That's interesting, against the British. Even though the British and the French, you know, Nasser is really defeated in this war. Of course, the Israelis join this war and defeat the Egyptian army. But Nasser, in a way, comes out of this smelling like a rose. Why? He tweaked the nose of the European colonial powers for the Third World. Those nations that are coming out of colonialism that did not want to either join the United States or the Soviet Union. He's a darling with that group. He dared tweak the nose of the British Lion and the French. Wow. He's popular. He's popular. He raised his stature, even though he loses. Interesting what you see develop here. It's fascinating. America, the United States, you know, we open up in an effort to maintain relations with other countries. Eisenhower's Adams for Peace speech in 1953. Anyone wants to indulge in nuclear energy for peaceful purposes as a friend here? The United States. And so in 1957, the Shah of Iran is going to appropriate money to open up a nuclear facility at the University of Tehran. And in 1959, we will give them their first reactor, their first batch of plutonium, and their first batch of uranium, and they're off and running. 1968, they will join the NPT Treaty, the Non-Proliferation Treaty. And then during the 1970s, the United States, France, Germany, Britain, Denmark, South Africa would be falling all over themselves to get a piece of the action because the Shah wants to erect a string of nuclear power plants because he understands that one day, perhaps, Iran's going to run out of oil. Of course, that'll change in 79. Interesting what you see develop here. Of course, we're getting more deeply involved in Vietnam. We're getting more deeply involved in Vietnam. Of course, Diem doesn't help. He's a very, very insular, draconian leader. Turns off many aspects of the Vietnamese social structure, religious types, students, academics, so on and so forth. Yet that's our boy. That's who we're going to support. And the North understands that they cannot deal with Diem, so what happens? 1959, the People's Liberation Armed Forces is formed, and a guerrilla war will really begin to start here. In South Vietnam, that's going to draw us into Vietnam. And then as he's leaving office, what is it that Mr. Eisenhower warns about? Beware the military-industrial complex. That was one of the highlights of his farewell address, almost hearkening back to the first farewell address this country ever had, and that's George Washington. Entangling alliances. You know, Mr. Washington was not concerned with trade deals. He was not concerned with opening up embassies abroad. He was afraid or concerned, let's put it that way, that entangling alliances, military alliances, would undermine the Constitution. Because once you have an alliance with somebody, aren't you obligated to answer that alliance if they so need help, so desire help, correct? Well, what happens if the president goes before Congress and puts forth the reasons for supposedly getting into a war and Congress says no? What happened to your credibility? Went out the window. That's what George Washington was against. And so Mr. Eisenhower kind of reinforces this with his farewell address. Beware the military-industrial complex. Interesting what you see develop here. But when he's out, Mr. Kennedy is in. We no longer have the new look defense. We now have something known as flexible response. We're going to maintain our nuclear posture, but raise the conventional posture. Henceforth, Vietnam. and by 1967, 68, we will have some 562,000 troops in Vietnam. Over 500,000 men in Vietnam. I always remember George Ball, when the discussions were going on in 61 in the Kennedy administration. Secretary McNamara wanted to put a lot of men in Vietnam. Walt Rostow did. There were others. And George Ball was one of those who told Kennedy, he tells him on November 7, 1961, he says, "Mr. President, if you listen to what they are telling you, in 5 years you'll have 300,000 men in Vietnam." And Kennedy's reply is, "George, you're considered one of the sharpest guys in Washington, but you're crazier than hell." What happened? What happened? Remember the Cuban Missile Crisis? Sure. Did we come fairly close to having exchange? Supposedly. But then again, look at Mr. Kennedy from when he became president. Remember the Bay of Pigs in Cuba? Of course, that was a plan that came out of the Eisenhower administration. He wanted no part of it. He backed out. Then the Cuban Missile Crisis. Of course, that wasn't a one-way street. Sure, the Russians took their missiles out of Cuba, but what did we have to do? Take our missiles out of Turkey? And at the same time, you know, Mr. Kennedy's in a quandary here. Do I make a greater commitment to Vietnam or not? He finally commits to allowing Diem to be taken out because the protests in South Vietnam against Diem's draconian approach to rule are reaching dangerous proportions. I always remember that as a kid. That was it the Daily Mirror or the New York, or the Daily News. That big full-page photo of that Buddhist monk on fire on a street corner in Saigon. Wow. Protesting. Wow. And Diem will be assassinated early November 1963, yet who will be assassinated as well 2.5 weeks later? Mr. Kennedy. Now, what I find interesting here is, you know, there are interests in this country who probably didn't like the fact that we didn't follow through with Cuba, that we didn't look strong enough with the Cuban Missile Crisis. But then again, look what happens in Russia, the Soviet Union. Who's going to be taken out of power the following year? Mr. Khrushchev. His idea of peaceful coexistence with the West. He's shaking his head no. Now, there are some of the more conservative elements in the Soviet leadership who don't agree with this policy, don't think it's working. And that's Leonid Brezhnev and Alexei Kosygin. Only they didn't assassinate Khrushchev. You know, they give him a few bucks with a dacha outside Moscow. All right, Nikita, take a break. Don't say a word and just go back to the house. Go to the house and keep your mouth shut. That's what they do. You know, Khrushchev really didn't want to up the ante in Vietnam. Brezhnev and Kosygin have no such impediments. And they're going to front North Vietnam $300 million worth of equipment to fight us in Vietnam. And so now we're stuck in that hellhole known as Vietnam. The Arabs, Middle East, the 67 war. The Israelis win that one in fine shape, didn't they? They will take the Sinai from Egypt. It seems like Israel has enlarged overnight. Almost like the, of course we don't do it by fighting, Louisiana Purchase. Of course, imperialism is imperialism, however way you look at it here. Whether you open your wallet or you shed some blood, it's still the same thing. Territorial aggrandizement is what it is. And so the Soviets, you know, it's interesting, the Soviets supposedly support the Egyptians and the Syrians. They don't make a very good show here. And that doesn't go unnoticed in Cairo and Damascus. Of course, at this stage, because of the fact he lost this war, Mr. Nasser, and this idea of this pan-Arabist movement is beginning to lose traction here. Keep in mind this idea of terrorism that you see today, some of it which is religiously inspired, not all of it, but some of it is, really wasn't the case in the 50s and the 60s. Many of these terrorists, like George Habash, Naif Hawatme, Wadi Haddad, these guys were secular. Many, some of them Marxists, some of them socialists. However, many of them were Christian, not even Muslim, Christian, and Palestinian nationalists. They wanted the Israelis out of Palestine. That's what they wanted. Of course, as rough as these guys were, they weren't cutting heads off. They weren't burning people in cages. That's not to say that they weren't rough. They were. Let's understand that one. They're terrorists, right? Well, let's call it this way. What they thought of themselves as, freedom fighters, the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine. Remember that one? The Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine, General Command, the PLO. Can't forget Yasser Arafat here. Can't forget him. So it's interesting what you're seeing develop. But after 67, you begin to see perhaps a rethinking here among certain people in the Middle East as to whether this pan-Arabist agenda is working. And so what are you going to see these people gravitating towards as the 60s give way to the 70s here? The old standby. Religion? That's coming. That's coming. They want Israel out of these areas, Palestine, but maybe they're going to change the rationale for doing so. So it's interesting what you're seeing develop here. Vietnam, the Tet Offensive, kind of changes everything. Even though Ho's people lose this battle tactically, or this offensive tactically, strategically, after looking at the Vietnam War, actually winds up as a win-win for him. What do you think happens to the displeasure of the American public with Vietnam after Tet? Does it go up? Yeah, it does. To the point where you see Mr. Johnson doing what in March? I shall not seek or accept my party's nomination. He's out. Is that regime change? Could be. Could be. Westmoreland will be out. And so you will see from 68 up till 73 this progression of less American attention being paid to Vietnam, to the point that they're going to pull the troops out eventually by 73. January 73. Yes?
Aren't you, I mean, in this talk, the philosophy of deterrence and the space race, the happiest day in Eisenhower's life when Sputnik was fired because right. It allowed us to...
Well, I haven't forgotten that yet.
But that changed... I mean, it just built upon the philosophy of deterrence, so the whole military philosophy
correct.
Was based on what the spy satellites could see.
Correct.
And just keeping the military budget slightly above what we needed...
Well, Sputnik helps that because Sputnik leads to that rationale that we're falling behind.
Well, it didn't, I mean, but it was Eisenhower. We could have sent up a Sputnik, but the fact that they sent Sputnik over the United States, they violated our airspace.
Right.
So it allowed us to violate Russia's airspace, therefore we could have the spy satellites, and we had the cameras, and Russia didn't.
Well, both sides were doing that. I remember when the SR-71 came out, you know, over 1,000 times we used to send the SR-71 along the Russian periphery to test their anti-aircraft posture.
Yeah.
And the fastest plane in the world. And every time they send a missile up, by the time it reached the altitude, the SR-71 is 20 miles downrange.
Yeah.
That thing flew as fast as a 30-06 bullet. In fact, they will do the same thing in 1970. The Air Force will do the same thing in 1978-79 over the Negev Desert, over the Israeli nuclear power plant there. And it's picked up on the Israeli radar. What is it? It's a peeper. What kind? SR-71. They're going to scramble two Phantom jets. Well, the SR-71, the crew got their pictures, put in the afterburners, and they're doing over 2,000 miles an hour. You think the Phantom's going to catch them? No.
We used to scramble against the U-2s.
Oh, yeah.
Going over Cuba.
Well, the U-2's a tugboat compared to the SR-71.
According to the Pentagon, they're only supposed to go 65, 70,000 feet.
Right.
So they were at 100,000 feet, and we weren't supposed to be able to pick them up, and we pick them up, and then we send two interceptors.
Well, that SR-71 is a fantastic aircraft. It was built with a slide rule in 9 months. And it's a flying gas tank, is virtually what it is. But try catching it. It goes as fast as a 30-06 bullet. In fact, when the British and the French first had that supersonic transport, remember that airliner, the Concorde? It crossed the Atlantic in just over 3 hours. One SR-71 left London bound for New York. It crossed the Atlantic in an hour and 58 minutes. You want to talk about moving? Interesting.
It still holds all kinds of speed records.
Oh, yes, it does. Oh, yes, it does. In fact, you can find a model of same on the deck of the Intrepid in New York City Harbor. Interesting plane. Interesting.
I read where on the ground, the SR-71 leaked fuel by design, but when it got up to speed, the friction, the airspeed, sealed up all the tanks. That's why they never fully fueled an SR-71 until it was ready to go.
Mm. Yeah, it's almost like you say, well, that's a dangerous way to operate, and yet at the same time, if you look at the Messerschmitt 163 from World War II, which was a rocket-type fighter, that thing only had 10 minutes flying time, and it was dangerous to land because of the small landing gear. So when you're building planes like this, and you're engaging in territory that maybe is for the first time. Or you're developing the technology, yeah, it can be somewhat dangerous. I won't tell you it's not. But yes, you see, going back to Sputnik, what's Mr. Kennedy going to say when he becomes president? We're going to the moon by the end of the decade? Didn't that galvanize the nation? Yeah, it sure did. It sure did. And did we back up his word by getting to the moon before the end of the decade of the 60s? Yes, we did. Was that kind of a beacon during that lousy Vietnam War? Yeah, it was. It was. It really was. But that doesn't deny the fact that at this time, the Russians are catching up. The nuclear deterrents are changing here. It's no longer just bombers with atomic weapons. You now have, at this point, submarines carrying atomic missiles. That's a nice mobile platform to have. It can be here, it can be here, it can be here. Sure, you have your bombers, Strategic Air Command. These guys are on the ground. It's interesting, if you go to, you used to go to these SAC bases, the crews had to stay together. They had to stay together. If two guys wanted to go to a movie and one guy didn't, guess what the one guy who didn't want to go to the movie had to do? Go to the movie. Because if you were called, everybody has to be together. And you had two crews for these bombers. And so what you did was everybody had to stay together. The missile silos, we had them all over the place. Well, you had some Alabama, Arkansas, Montana. But they're immobile. They're not, that's not mobility. A plane is mobility. However, the submarine? And so you don't have to have the longest range missiles in a submarine, because a submarine can close somebody's coast. But when you get to Vietnam, Secretary of State McNamara is understanding how much of an economic impact the war and maintaining the nuclear ability is having on the United States taxpayer. And so it begins, you're not only having negotiations to end the Vietnam War, you are now having negotiations between us and the Soviet Union, what's later going to be known as the Strategic Arms Limitation Talks, which will be signed in May 72. And the idea here is it's beginning to gain credence with the defense establishment, at least with the politicals like McNamara, that perhaps we do not need to have absolute superiority. How about parity? Maybe that will limit the Soviets from trying to gain superiority. This is almost the same rationale that Germans had with their fleet in 1914, 1915, 1916. The Germans didn't build as large a navy as the British. They didn't have that shipbuilding capacity. But German ships per unit were better than the British Navy. And the idea here was, you know, if we can cut the British fleet down to size with certain engagements, the British will leave us alone. Of course, that's not what's going to happen here. Is this the same rationale with the Defense Department here? Could be. But the idea is to cut down on this nuclear arms race. Again, it's not too much different than what the British saw when the First World War was over with. Their economy, you know, the economy was in peril here in England. They know the United States' potential to build a large navy. So February 8, 1922, let's have a naval agreement between us, the Americans, and the Japanese. Of course, the British are getting away from the Japanese, and they're gravitating closer to us. And they'll get that agreement. For every 5 American ships that are built, the British will build 5 warships. The Japanese, 3. And so you're finding, even in a country like the United States, the richest country in the world, there are limits. Of course, again, you know, big powers like the United States and the Soviet Union like continuity. You know, big powers don't like surprises here. They like continuity. Sure, the North Vietnamese are going to win the Vietnam War, and we're going to be defeated, and we're going to have to rebuild the army. But look at it from the Soviet perspective. And this is what I like. Step back from the United States, look at it from the Soviet perspective. Yeah, this is great. The North Vietnamese, our client, has defeated the United States in the Vietnam War. We got them stuck here and we bled them. That's terrific. However, what else is on the table here? You know, you've seen this split at this time, going through the 50s and the 60s and the early 70s, split between the Soviet Union and China, the giants of the so-called communist world. And so what's Mr. Nixon gonna do in the early 70s here? Open up relations with China? That's exactly what he's going to do. Play one off against the other. Interesting what you're seeing develop here. We're going to sign the strategic arms limitation talks, but at the same time, politically, we're going to open up relations with China, which we might as well have done anyway. It's the world's most populous nation. You're going to divorce yourself from 20% of the world's population? What the heck's the matter with you? I remember that one question National Geographic asked people going back about 10 years ago. What is the world's most spoken language? Many people here thought it was Spanish.
Chinese.
Mandarin? 20% of the world's population is Chinese, 1.5 billion people. A lot more people speaking Chinese than Spanish here. That same series of questions, they asked people. You know, it was after Katrina, actually. I guess the storm Katrina, and they said 30% of Americans they asked couldn't find Mississippi on a map. 40% couldn't find Louisiana. 75% couldn't find Iraq after 3 years of war. Iraq. Couldn't find Iraq. That's all right. They were asking some Americans, what's Ukraine? Some thought it was a city in the Kansas.
Where?
Ukraine, Kansas.
And these people vote.
And she says these people vote. Anyway. Beg your pardon? He says they're procreating. That's a comforting thought. But anyway, you see in the early 70s here, let's take a look at this from the Soviet perspective. You see here by the end of the, let's go to the end of the Vietnam War. Sure, you had the strategic arms limitation talks, and there's rough parity between the nuclear powers. And the United States has to redo its military, its ground force, its army. At the same time here, now this is fascinating too, the British in 1969, informed the United States, we can no longer be the policemen of the Gulf. They had some troops in the Gulf states. This is nowhere near what the British were doing in 1914, 1918, 1940. Nowhere near. It's a token force. However, they can't afford this anymore. And they announced by 71, we're pulling out. Interesting how Saddam waits till the British are gone and then in 1972 announces he's nationalizing Iraqi oil. Having done that, we can't do that. We can't replace the British. We're still stuck in Vietnam. And plus, we need to maintain troop strength in Europe in the face of those Soviet tank armies. Have to do that. Can't have Israel do it, despite the fact they have the best military in the Middle East. They're not politically palatable. And you're going to have that war in 1973 anyway. So who's going to step up to the plate here? The Shah. He will be the overseer for the Western interests here, militarily speaking. He'll be the guy to oversee this. And he's obviously going to be lavished with money. Well, he was being lavished anyway. We helped to build the Sabak, which was based off the Gestapo, to keep the Iranian people in line. However, again, looking at the Soviets here, you know, you go to the 73, the Yom Kippur War. Sadat. You know, Sadat's interesting here. You know, when they lose this war, and they almost win this war in the beginning, they almost win this war. But the Soviets, again, do not help them. There was the threat of the Moscow saying we're going to send in airborne divisions. And what does Kissinger tell them? Go ahead. Because he put U.S. nuclear forces on alert. Keep in mind, by this time, Nixon's having a problem with that thing known as Watergate. And so at this point, Sadat comes to the realization, this idea of working with the Soviets isn't working too well. So what's going to happen after that war? Who is he going to throw his lot with? The United States. Economically speaking, it's a lot better deal. Because what's eventually going to happen with that deal? Aren't they getting $2 billion a year from us after this? Yeah, they are. You know, a currency that's a lot stronger than the ruble is. But again, look at this from the Soviet perspective. After, you know, you can go into 75, after the North Vietnamese take South Vietnam. You've seen several things develop here. The Cubans are going to be in Angola, helping the Angolans. And that's going to help undermine the apartheid government eventually in South Africa. This idea of this revolutionary war. I mean, that's the one thing you got to say about Castro. Many people here may not like him, but he did one thing for Cuba. They became an independent nation. You can't take that away from him, despite whatever government he has. Can't take that away. Well, let's so-called spread the joy here. You want to call it that. This idea of revolutionary nationalism still resonates from 45. The North Vietnamese are in Cambodia taking care of their so-called previous ally known as Pol Pot. A disreputable character if ever there was one. If you remember what he did to those people in Cambodia, exterminated 20% of the population, 1.5 million people. Even if you even had a little old savings account, you were considered a capitalist. It boggles the mind here, it really does. So you have the North Vietnamese army now in Cambodia fighting a Chinese client known as the Khmer Rouge. And you have at the same time the Cubans, as if you want to call them proxies from Moscow, in Africa, fighting in Angola. You know, and Russia's trying to install a socialist government in Kabul. And so the rationale begins to be formed in Russia for the Soviet Union. Well, we got the North Vietnamese fighting, we got the Cubans fighting. What about us? Maybe it's time we stepped up to the plate, put our money where our mouths are. Put our money where our mouths are. Interesting. Interesting what you see develop here. And again, as we go along through the 70s, what's going to happen in 78? The revolt in Iran? The Iranian Revolution. And who's eventually going to win that one? The Ayatollah and the Shia fundamentalists. Now the agenda really changes here. Now the agenda really changes. Look at it not only from the Russian perspective, but from the perspective of Sunni Muslims. We now have a Shia fundamentalist regime in Tehran. At the same time, the Russians are trying to maintain a regime, and as they call it, one of a socialist orientation. It's a lackey government. A socialist or the proletarian revolution in Kabul. Let me ask you a question. Again, we get back to this proletarian revolution garbage. Originally, the intent is based off the European factory worker. That's what Marx saw. How many factory workers are there in Afghanistan?
Lots of farmers.
Lots of farmers. Now we're back to what? The peasant again? Okay. Interesting what you see develop here. And in December 1979, the Russians are going to take out Taraki, install Babrak Karmal, and they're going to put their own troops in Afghanistan. So now you have Russian troops in Afghanistan, the North Vietnamese in Cambodia, Cubans in Africa. It looks like they're really on the march here, doesn't it? But let's look at it again from the Sunni perspective. We now have a fundamentalist regime in Tehran, which are Shias, not Sunnis, and on top of that, they're not even Arabs, they're Persians. Yeah. And now we have infidels now in Kabul. Let's understand one thing here. You know, you can insert your lackey in Kabul, but do you think the people in the countryside really go along? No. Whenever there's a president in Kabul, it seems like he's really the mayor of Kabul or Kabul. Most people in the countryside don't listen to what they're told from Kabul. What are they going to listen to him for? And so now the world is changing. The United States is rebuilding its army. We are going to, you know, we're maintaining our nuclear posture, but at the same time, we're rebuilding the army. Colin Powell, people like Don Starry, Ben Traynor, you know, they understand that we cannot make the same mistake we made in Vietnam. They're going to go with an all, they're going to do away with conscription. They're going to go with an all-volunteer army and a so-called bona fide National Guard, and this army should not be used. I mean, I heard Colin Powell even say this. This army should not be used unless at the behest of the American public. Does that sound like some of the founding fathers? Yeah, to a certain extent, yes. Yes. And Madeleine Albright is later going to tell him, well, you're always talking about how great this army is. Why don't we use it? And so by 1979, the seeds are being set here for the eventual collapse of the Soviet Union. They're going to get involved in Afghanistan just like we got involved in Vietnam. The Middle East is changing. You now have a Shia fundamentalist regime in Tehran. You know, the Shias have been taking it on the chin here from the Sunnis. Now maybe they have a regime that will lead them. They're Persians. But now the Shias are only 15% of the religion anyway. But does that accentuate the divide here? Yes, it does. Because in 1979, who's going to assume the presidency in Iraq? Saddam Hussein. And he has been up to this point, using that oil money, you can say anything you want about him, but he's been using that oil money to modernize Iraq, educating the women. They're going to get better jobs, medical care for everybody, build up the roads, bridges, the cities. You know, in his eyes, and he's not too far off. Egypt is doing this. No longer is Egypt that poster child expression for the so-called pan-Arabist movement. Somebody else has to rise to the fore, and he thinks it's going to be him. Of course, what he's done is the same thing Stalin did, if you want to call it this, to Bolshevism or communism. He's nationalizing it. This idea, this Ba'athist idea of this pan-Arabist movement, no. He localizes it using the Ba'ath Party for, that's his party, to lead this country. So now the globe is transforming here. It's interesting what you're seeing develop here. It's fascinating to see. Yet lurking in the background is still that nuclear, that sword of Damocles. So you haven't had, you know, the nuclear weapons here, you haven't had another large knockdown, drag-out war like 1939, 1945. That's been accomplished. But you've had these brush fire conflicts, and again, it goes back to what I mentioned before. For those of you who remember this, a man I mentioned him before, Roger Trinquier, who wrote that study at the Army, the General Command of Staff College, 1962, when he said he was talking about the change in the world, and he said after 1945. You know, many people are under the illusion that we're still 1945, that many of the soldiers wear uniforms, Russians, British, American, whatever. No, the guerrilla and the terrorist. Refute that. He writes this in 1962, after having served in the French Army in North Vietnam and having fought against the Algerians, two losing causes. And this is what he says. You're missing out if you don't think this is true. It will be these brushfire wars. The new soldier, the new enemy, if you want to call him that, is the guerrilla and the terrorist. Has he been right? It would seem so. And that study was written in 1962. We're over 50 years past that. What's changed here? Interesting what you saw develop here. Absolutely fascinating. The world is changing. And when we come back next week, I'm going to do 79 up till now. The demise of the Soviet Union. That's a big one. What does that mean? What is that going to mean? Interesting what you see develop. Anybody have any questions or comments? Yes?
I'm really curious. Somehow I've never understood why Russia invaded Afghanistan. And save ourselves. I know why we went through there. I don't know what the hell we're still doing there. But why did they come in? What were they going to gain?
You know, there are foreign policy makers who really don't understand why the Russians went there. Some
not
say,
just me being stupid.
Well, no, you're not. Some say, well, if they can take control of Afghanistan, it's a stepping stone toward perhaps that area of Pakistan that's on the Arabian Sea. That will get them closer naval-wise to the Middle East. Then there's always, in fact, someone brought up the fact that back in the was it 1920s? When, you know, the fledgling Bolshevik movement looking to spread their idealism. Trotsky was saying one way to get to Europe was through Afghanistan, supposedly.
Over all the mountains?
Afghanistan and then go west. Through Persia, what you call Turkey today, and so on, and that'll get us into Southern Europe. That's supposedly what he said. I've tried to look for that, and I haven't found that. But that's supposedly one rationale.
Hard way of doing it.
Yeah, it sure is. But keep in mind one thing here. This is what the British always fear, that you know, during their term of the Great Game, they thought the 18th century, 19th century, that if one of these unwanted competitors, like Tsarist Russia, went down the Tigris and Euphrates rivers into the Persian Gulf through the Strait of Hormuz, you're on the Arabian Sea and you're in colonial India. That's how they saw this. Well, there's no colonial India anymore. There's now Pakistan, and Afghanistan is landlocked. But the idea would be virtually the same. If you can take Afghanistan, bully Pakistan, or take Pakistan, you're right on the Arabian Sea. Now you're not all that far from the Persian Gulf. That's been brought up as a rationale for what the Soviets did. But the problem here is, and I'll get into this more next week, many Russian soldiers were told, you're going there to protect a country from capitalist intrusion. And so when the Russian soldiers get there, they find these people hate them. Something's not right here. I'm told that I'm going there to liberate these people, and then I get there, they hate my guts. And they do. They do. And so you don't think that leads to some of these Russian or Soviet soldiers being befuddled? Yeah. Yep. And what's going to happen after a long time here? Oh, let's get out of here. So, anybody else have any questions or comments? No? We're done.
Thank you.
You're welcome.